Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We will start our lecture on pathology of esophagus as a part of the GIT pathology series of lectures. This is the gross appearance of the esophagus on the stomach. On the left side, there's an esophagus that appears as white color, while on the right side is the stomach that appears as the brown color. The difference in the color in this gross appearance of the stomach and the esophagus related to the lining epithelium. The esophagus is lined by the stratified squamous epithelium, and the stomach is lined by the mucin-secreting glandular structure. And there's boundaries between this and the between the esophagus and the stomach or the cardia of the stomach. We will discuss in our lecture many topics, including the congenital disorder of esophagus, acquired motor disorder, vascular disorder, inflammatory disorder, and the premalignant lesion in form of Barrett esophagus and the tumors. The most important significant in the esophagus that the various pathology, whether mild, moderate, or even advanced pathology like the tumor and malignancy, all these are shared in the limited number of the symptoms. All the pathologies of the esophagus were either mild, simple inflammatory process, or advanced malignant disorder shared in the limited number of symptoms. The first are dysphagia, that is a difficulty in the swallowing. This dysphagia may be functional or organic. Functional means there is a deranged esophageal motor function. And organic means there is narrowing or obstruction of the lumen. بكلا الحالتين سواء كان functional or organic, there is a certain dysphagia, and this disorder are seen in a lots of the esophageal pathology. The second is the heart burn, retrosternal burning pain that are associated with the regurgitation of the gastric content, that to say related to the defect in the lower esophageal sphincter with the return of the gastric content to the lower end of esophagus that result in the sensation of heartburn. The second is the vomiting of blood, or what we named as hematemesis. The fourth is the melena, blood in the stool, that associated with the severe inflammatory process, ulceration or laceration. Fifth is the respiratory symptom, because the esophagus is adjacent to the bronchial tree. Sometimes regurgitation can be seen from the esophagus to the respiratory passage, and may result in the dyspnea, cough, and aspiration can be associated. Start with the congenital anatomical disorder. This is a congenital, so present at birth with vomiting and aspiration. So, as we said, دائما يكون الاسوفيغس قريب من bronchial tree, as entrance of bronchial tree, so that any defect or problem in the esophagus are referred or reflected toward the respiratory passage in form of the aspiration that result in the asphyxia, pneumonia, and because of this condition may associate with the gastric distension. The first of congenital anatomical disorder is the agenesis. Agenesis means absence of esophagus, which is a very rare condition. The second is the atresia, which means atresia, failure of development of a segment of esophagus, which is replaced by a thin non-carinized cord, that to say absence of lumen with formation of upper and lower pouch associated with the tracheoesophageal fistula. This type of the disorder, as we see here in the picture, associated with failure of development of the lumen associated with the tracheoesophageal fistula. As you see here, this is a normal anatomy, and this atresia with distal fistula formation, tracheoesophageal fistula, and this atresia with the proximal and distal fistula, and this is proximal fistula, distal atresia, or proximal and distal atresia, or there's a fistula between tracheoesophageal fistula. So that atresia may associated with the fistula with the tracheoesophageal opening. The third is the stenosis, developmental defect resulting in the partial obstruction or narrowing of the esophageal lumen. هذه الحالة stenosis, there is no absence of the lumen, but there is narrowing of the lumen or sometimes even obstruction. Both conditions require urgent medical and surgical intervention to correct this anatomical congenital defect. Acquired anatomical disorder including stenosis. So the stenosis may be congenital, may be acquired. In both cases, there is a narrowing of the lumen. In the congenital, may associate with the fistula. In the acquired, caused by the caustic strictures, that to say, associated with both surgical inflammatory process, tumors, autoimmune disease like the systemic sclerosis or what named scleroderma. All these conditions are associated narrowing of the lumen of the esophagus. Another topic in the acquired esophageal disorder is the whip and ring. Whip and ring, there's a mean there's narrowing in the lumen caused by the in the whip caused by mucosal fault, while in the ring caused by the muscular hypertrophy. That results in both cases there is narrowing of the lumen of esophagus. That to say there is partial occlusion of the luminal pathway of the esophagus in whip and rings. Another acquired disorder is the diverticuli that are referred to the outpouching of esophageal wall, and this is often not associated with the bleeding. Hiatal hernia. Hiatal hernia mean protrusion of a dilated sac-like segment of stomach above the diaphragm. This on the stomach will be protruded upward above the diaphragm to the thoracic cavity. That incidence of this condition is occurring about 1 to the 20% of adults, increase with age, mostly asymptomatic. أغلب الحالات هي asymptomatic. Most of the patients that having hiatal hernia have no symptom. Later on, symptoms can be appear later on. The clinical presentation including heartburn, regurgitation of the gastric juice in the 9% due to the lower esophageal incompetence that associated with the hiatal hernia. The hiatal hernia associated with the lower esophageal competence with the regurgitation of the gastric juice toward the lower end of esophagus, and it is related to the symptom. That to say, the regurgitation is related to the position of the patient, and the symptoms are accentuated or increased by the certain position that are favoring reflex. So, hiatal hernia and reflex are usually associated, although they are not a single entity, but are usually associated with each other. And there is a certain position that are favoring a reflex that associated with the hiatal hernia. Patients with the severe reflex esophagitis usually have hiatal hernia. However, the hiatal hernia and reflex are not the same condition, but usually associated with each other. Because of the prolonged reflex of the gastric content toward the lower end of esophagus, this results in the esophageal mucosal inflammation and possible ulceration. But bleeding, if occur, is minor. Usually not typical massive bleeding can be associated with the lower esophageal inflammatory process that associated with the hiatal hernia and reflex of the gastric content. There are two types of the hiatal hernia, the sliding axial, and this was the most common, represent about 95% of the cases. And the second is paraaxial, paraesophageal, non-axial or rolling type. Sliding means there is a protrusion of the stomach above the segment above of the stomach above the diaphragm. There is no any defect in the diaphragm, but the problem are related to the protrusion of pill-like part of the cardia above the diaphragm. This is a normal condition with the lower esophageal sphincter directly in related to the diaphragm. While in the hiatal hernia type 1, there is a protrusion of the bull-like protrusion of the cardia above the diaphragm, and this is the sliding type. Well, bull-shaped dilatation is due to the long-standing congenital short esophagus. المشكلة في ال sliding type إنه المشكلة في الأسوفيجس. The problem in the esophagus that results in the shortening and pulling up part of the stomach to be extended above the diaphragm, like that of the stricture or spasm or fibrous scarring of esophagus, resulting in the traction on the stomach. The main problem or the main pathology in the sliding type in the esophagus that are resulting in the traction of the stomach upward. While the second type, which is paraesophageal or non-axial or also known as rolling type, segment of cardia of the stomach dissect along the esophagus through a defect in the diaphragm. That to say, there is a the site of the lower esophageal sphincter is still intact site in relation to the diaphragm, but part of the cardia of the stomach are protruded upward toward the thoracic cavity in adjacent to the esophagus through a defect in the diaphragm. So, paraesophageal type associated with a defect in the diaphragm, while the rolling type are related to the pathology of the esophagus that result in the shortening of the esophagus and pushing part of the stomach pulling traction upward toward the thoracic cavity. Sometimes mixture of both can be seen when there is a shortening of the esophagus that are pulling the stomach traction upward and defect in the diaphragm that allow the part of the cardia to roll adjacent to the esophagus, so that this is a mixture type of the sliding and paraesophageal type. This paraesophageal type may follow this segment of the stomach that are protruded through the diaphragmatic defect, may strangulated or even infarction can be seen. The second topics of the acquired motor disorder of esophagus are achalasia. As you know, during the swallowing, there is a coordinated movement between the peristalsis movement of the esophagus and the lower esophageal sphincter relaxation to allow the passage of the material downward toward the stomach. In achalasia, there is a failure of relaxation, or there is incomplete relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter. That to say, there is a smooth muscle relaxation of the esophageal defect in response to the swallowing, producing functional obstruction and dilatation of more proximal esophagus. كأنه there is a obstruction. Really, it's not obstructed, not a organic. It is a functional obstruction of the lower esophageal sphincter due to the defect in the coordination movement of the peristalsis and relaxation of the smooth muscle that result in the failure of relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter. This is this condition results in the progressive dysphagia to the liquid and solid material and associated with nocturnal regurgitation because of the lower esophageal obstruction are usually associated with the proximal esophageal dilatation, and there is an accumulation of material with the nocturnal regurgitation can be seen, and aspiration of undigested food and result in the aspiration pneumonia because of the adjacent site of the entrance of the esophagus and the trachea. So, the trait characteristic of achalasia are a peristalsis of esophagus, defect in the peristalsis movement of esophagus. The second is partial relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter. And the third is the increased basal tone of lower esophageal sphincter. So that there's a defect in the coordination movement, finally result in the functional obstruction of the lower esophagus. So, the underlying pathogenic background of this disorder are the deranged innervation of the lower esophageal sphincter. As we say, there's a coordination, the coordination movement of the peristalsis and relaxation of lower esophagus are deranged, or there's a defect in the coordination movement of lower esophageal sphincter between the neuromuscular coordination and the absent myenteric ganglia in the body of esophagus. The myenteric ganglia in the body of esophagus are absent, so that there is a defect in the peristalsis and defect in the innervation of the sphincter that results in the failure of the relaxation completely, that results in the what we named as achalasia. Regarding the macroscopical picture of the lower end of esophagus may be normal, because the problem initially it is a neuromuscular disorder regarding the coordination of movement and the physiology of the peristalsis and muscle contraction and the smooth muscle relaxation and so on. There is no organic pathology in the esophagus. Or because of this disorder, movement may result in the hypertrophic or thinning of the muscle associated with the mucosal inflammation, sometimes ulceration or even fibrosis. There are two types of the achalasia. The primary or way which is most common, no underlying cause, is a sporadic. The secondary type that are related to the underlying different disease or different pathology, like the Chagas disease, that caused by Trypanosoma cruzi infection, causing destruction of myenteric plexus ganglia in the GIT and in the ureter. This Trypanosoma is a parasite that are infected and destructing the ganglion cells, plexus in the GIT and ureter, resulting in the failure of peristalsis. As we said, there is a defect in the peristalsis movement of esophagus, and esophageal dilatation, because there is failure of passage of the material, that result in the functional obstruction, and mega duodenal, mega colon, mega ureter. All this mega is related to the failure of the passage. كأنه هناك obstruction, لكن حقيقة هو it's a functional obstruction related to the destruction of the ganglia in the GIT and the ureter. GIT including the esophagus, duodenal, intestine, and the colon. All this defect associated with the progressive dilatation of the luminal component of the of the GIT. Diabetes is like the neuropathy and vagus nerve injury. All this can result in the damaging of the neural component of the physiology, that result in the progressive dilatation and failure of the opening lumen, and so that there is a failure of the that result in the obstruction, what we named as functional obstruction. Infiltrative disease, like malignancy, amyloidosis, sarcoidosis, all this can be associated with a defect and damaging of the neuromuscular coordination that result in the functional obstruction. المشكلة في نهايتها is a functional obstruction that are related to the destruction of the ganglion cells that are responsible for the neuromuscular coordination. So, this achalasia may associate with the complication in form of the squamous cell carcinoma in the 5%, usually in the younger age than that patient without disease. Esophageal laceration is another topic that we will discuss in this lecture. Esophageal laceration, or also known as Mallory-Weiss syndrome. Mallory-Weiss syndrome is a longitudinal mucosal tear at the esophageal-gastric junction. At the esophageal-gastric junction, there's a mucosal tear that are longitudinal. This type of the tear encountered in the alcoholic person after bouts of severe retching or vomiting, usually secondary to the acute alcoholic intoxication. Those alcoholic person may showing or complaining of severe vomiting that associated with the contraction of the stomach and result in the longitudinal tear in the lower esophageal gastric junction because of inadequate relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter muscle during the vomiting attack, during the vomitus attack, that usually associated with inadequate relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter, and so there is a pressure of on the mucosa that results in the vomiting. This linear ulceration or irregular ulceration or laceration may be small size in the few millimeter to centimeter in the length and may occur without any evidence of vomiting. Involve the mucosa or sometimes maybe extend deeply penetrating the wall and perforating the wall can be seen in about 10% of the cases involving the GIT of the massive hematemesis. That to say, hematemesis may complaining this laceration, however the majority don't cause profuse bleeding. Not require surgical intervention because most of the cases are mucosal tear only, there's no involvement of the wall, but sometimes rarely can be involving the wall, resulting in the penetration of the esophageal wall, and heal tend to be rapid and complete. So that is, most of the cases are superficial related to the mucosa only, but rarely catastrophic complication can be seen. Sometimes perforation of the wall may result in the release of the content toward the mediastinum, result in severe mediastinitis that requires surgical intervention. أغلب الحالات simple, superficial related to the mucosal tear, but sometimes penetration of the wall can be result in the severe condition like that of severe mediastinitis. This is a picture of the laceration that are longitudinal tear with perforation. This is the tear and this is a perforation that are seen in the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis and even the serosa, and this may associated with the leakage of the material toward the mediastinum, result in the severe mediastinitis that are considered as the catastrophic condition. Vascular lesion of the esophagus, esophageal varices. Esophageal varices, as you know, there is a portal systemic shunting between the systemic circulation and portal circulation. This shunting occurs at the site of anastomosis, where at the lower end of esophagus, periumbilical, lower anal anastomosis, and retroperitoneal. This shunting of the blood from the portal to the systemic and the reverse from the systemic to the portal occur as a part of the physiology, but sometimes because of the increase in the portal hypertension, for example, we are talking about the esophageal varices, that to say there's engorgement of the lower esophageal venous plexus due to the portal hypertension that are result in the reverse of the blood from the portal to the systemic circulation. And so because of the portal hypertension leading to the formation of portosystemic collateral bypass channels. This channel really is present normally, but there is no evidence of the shunting too much in the normal physiology. But when there is an increase in the portal hypertension that's occur most commonly in the cirrhotic patient, there is a shunting of the blood will be passed through this condition. In this condition where there is a cirrhosis in the liver, there is impairment of the blood flow within the portal circulation, so that shunting of the blood will pass from the portal to the systemic through the azygous vein, finally in the lower end of esophagus. This shunting of the blood will result in the engorgement of the venous plexus in the lower end of esophagus, and so the collateral vein will develop in the region of the lower esophagus when the portal flow is diverted through coronary vein of the stomach into the plexus of esophagus, submucosal vein into the azygous vein finally. So shunting of blood occurs as a result of the impairment of the blood flow within the portal circulation as a result of the cirrhosis in the liver, and so the shunting of blood will pass to the systemic circulation and finally will pass to the azygous vein in the lower end of esophagus. This shunting of the blood will result in the engorgement of the venous plexus in the lower end of esophagus, and so most commonly caused in the portal hypertension in the cirrhotic liver. Rare cases can be seen other than the cirrhotic liver, including portal venous thrombosis, hepatic venous thrombosis, Bedi-Chiari syndrome, bilifluvitis, or tumor, sometimes compression or invasion to the major portal radicals. All this may compress the portal flow. The main problem is the impairment of the portal flow of the blood, so that there is a shunting from the portal to the systemic through the coronary veins of the cardia of the stomach and pass to the lower esophageal venous plexus to pass to the zygous vein, so that the main problem are portal hypertension resulting in the collateral shunting of the blood to the systemic in the lower end of esophagus, resulting in the engorgement of the blood vessels in this plexus. So, grossly appear as the tortuous dilated veins directly beneath mucosa or in the periesophageal tissue. The overlying mucosa may be normal or eroded and inflamed, with or without thrombosis can be seen. Clinically asymptomatic, varices will be asymptomatic until they rupture. And this is very, very dangerous condition, because most of the cases are asymptomatic in the patient with the with hepatic problem, hepatic cirrhosis and so, until they rupture when massive hematemesis result. Rupture may be spontaneous or secondary to the vomiting, resulting in the hemorrhage, and rarely subside spontaneously. That to say, rupture may be spontaneous or secondary to the vomiting. That to say, maybe spontaneous rupture, and it's very dangerous because the patient are initially it's asymptomatic, and the rupture of the engorged plexus may be spontaneous and resulting in the hemorrhage that are rarely subside spontaneous with the high rate of mortality. 40% will die after first episodes. أول attack تعطينا 40% mortality, نسبة عالية من ال death. 40% will die after the first episode, and the 50% of survival will re-bleed, with each re-bleed mortality about 40%, so that a high rate of mortality associated with esophageal varices. In the 2/3 of cirrhotic patient, this condition can develop and account for the 40% of death in the liver cirrhosis. This is the gross appearance for the lower end of esophagus. This is a rupture, and this is engorged submucosal vessels in the esophagus, and this is the stomach that are joined to the lower end of esophagus. Thank you very much.